Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the first session of this new initiative that we're launching jointly with the Real Instituto Elcano and the National G Foundation. And we want to open a reflection on the geopolitical pathways on energy transition. And we're now focusing on a specific area of the world, and which is the Middle East. And in this first session that we are holding both face-to-face here in the auditorium with over 600 people who were registered online. We are lucky to have for this opening event with José Juan Ruiz, President of Real Instituto Elcano, and Francisco Reynés, President of Natochi, and to whom I'm going to give the floor to open the session. Thank you, Manuel, and good morning. Good morning, everybody. Both those of you here in Avenida de America and those of you who are online. I believe that in these kind of sessions that we are opening today, Natochi is offering the tank and Instituto Elcano is offering the think. So, and I think that that's what's good actually, because as we were mentioning before the opening event, we need think and we need data and we need people who can help us think and have opinions based on facts and less opinions based on other opinions. The world today is just full of baseless opinions. And if we are thinking about the world of energy, unlikely a topic that might be hard and not very appealing for many. But we really do need to have some of the things clear. So we hope this kind of event is useful in that sense. The first thing I have to do is to thank and feel honored to have Instituto Elcano as part of, with us in these events that we're starting today. I believe that we all know how amazing the Instituto Elcano is, and they're going to add to these sessions the serenity and the depth that's required to be able to have a series of opinions and conversations with a solid base. And the reason for this event and the title, I mean, of course, it could have been more of a hot topic. I mean, energy transition, if we had said that we were going to talk about energy, only energy, of course, that's one, something on the table and everybody's talking about it for several reasons. And for many geopolitical and economic and strategic ideas. But if we link it to energy transition, it's even more on the table. Nobody today is questioning that we have to tackle the issue. We are, I mean, it's just enough to get out of the building, and we are 6 degrees above the average temperature of the month of May. So, of course, we have to face the climate change issue, and all of the society has to face it. And Natochi Foundation is betting on understanding how to face it from the energy perspective, which is one of the many players involved who can do something to improve it. And I believe we could, I mean, there isn't much more to say about climate change because most has already been said, but on behalf of Natochi, I would like to once again insist, and I try to do so every time I have the occasion, on the way to tackle it, is that each country should find a customized approach, because each country has a different base situation, and every country and every energy structure come from a certain legacy, and we're seeing that today in many of the circumstances in Europe, nuclear years or no, and coal years or no, and gas years or no, and that's where we're at. And renewable energies as well, they have, been developed at different paces. I would also like to say one more thing, which is that how we tackle this energy transition should take into account the impact on climate change, but not only that, it should only be aware of its impact on the development of countries and the well-being of citizens and the economic development of countries. it isn't just one of the vectors, but we have to take both things into account. And so in the world transition is important because it needs to help each state and each region in the world transition from where they are to where they should be, trying to combine these two different aspects. And I believe that respecting these differences should involve all the countries and all the regions. So it is just as important to respect those differences as to try to get the commitment of countries and regions to make sure that we can have action plans that are practical. And the last concept I would like to mention is that we have to be pragmatic and practical. In many cases, we see very long-term solutions, and we are more concerned on the goal and rather than the path. But what's actually hard is to build that path and make sure that this new path that we're building is compatible with the two things I just mentioned: facing climate change and facing it, understanding that of course we have to be ambitious, but we have to be aware of where we're starting and what we can achieve. And I believe that these conferences that we starting today are the starting point of many conferences that with the view of Instituto Elcano, we are able to clarify many things. And starting the Middle East is starting at the birthplace of this dilemma that started many years ago. And some of us, unluckily, were already in college with the oil crisis and the end of the 70s and early 80s in the Middle East. But it's expanded to different places. And I believe that the panel of experts we've got today is great to be able to talk about what we are here to talk about. So once again, welcome to NATO G Foundation and in our offices. I hope this is the start of a very interesting dialogue in the future. And I want to thank Instituto Elcano for being the thinking part of this adventure. And thank you everybody for being here. Well, thank you, Francisco and José Juan, from the Real Instituto Elcano and a think tank that's a reference, and you are co-organizing this event. What was the main reason that you found to launch this sort of initiative? Well, first of all, thank you, everybody. Thank you, Francisco. Thank you for your words towards Real Instituto Elcano. And the truth is that it is us who are honored. Elcano is an institute that analyzes with the data and independently the big issues that Spanish society is facing and that Spanish companies are facing. And without the support of sponsors like you, it'll be extremely hard to do our job. And I believe that in your intervention, of course, I support it. And I believe there are two ideas that are very important and that I would like to place at the front of this dialogue. First is facta non verba. So I'm an economist, and I have devoted all of my life to giving priority to data. Without data and data points, we cannot think. We're blinded. And we have the obligation of making sure that all that data are comprehensible and to be able to shed some light on the solutions, not the problems, but rather the solutions for those problems. And that's the commitment that Elcano has with its sponsors and Spanish society, do data-based analysis. And we can only do that thanks to your support. And the second idea I would like to highlight is that for a long time, we have preached in the desert as a think tank, because big part of our audiences thought that geopolitics was luxury, was everybody, that only a few that only had to deal with esoteric themes could devote a little time to. But what we're seeing now and what it is showing now is that geopolitics is a need, and geopolitical analysis is a need, is a must, not just for political parties or politicians or the politics. It's actually required and a must for companies and societies, because without geopolitical assessment, we could be making decisions that are going to bring us to a cul-de-sac. And this is what we're seeing after the invasion of the Ukraine. I believe that there's an essential geopolitical topic here, which is that Europe is going to have to reduce its energy dependence from Russia, which is a shock for the whole offer and energy offer and demand map in the world. And I mean, it changes the map of who are more of best friends or not that good friends. So we have to, I mean, that change in the map is going to take place irrespective of whether we want it or not. And that's something that we have to assess. And those who devote their lives to these, I mean, we are delighted to tackle it with data, with our best researchers like Gonzalo, you know, and the people who work at the Institute. And that's our commitment to carry out this geopolitical analysis that are needed. But there's something else, which is something that's more structural. The urgency of things sometimes hides which are the vectors for structural changes that are taking place, and those vectors of structural change that are taking place, such as, you know, policies against climate change and energy transition, are things that are going to be with us for a long time, and they're above short-term needs. And an economist like me knows that the mid and short and long term are determined, that mid and long term are determined by the decisions you make in the short term. And there are some decisions. I mean, you cannot make decisions on incentives for the short term without taking into account the consequences, desired and undesired consequences of those incentives that move investments. We are talking about processes that are going to last for 10, 15, 20, or 30 years. Can be the volatility in incentives, but if it exists, we cannot predict which is the result we're going to end up with, as some people try to do sometimes. That's why it is so important to be able to seed with the data and have a dialogue with independents to analyze and assess, to try to understand how the short-term and mid- and long-term decisions are linked. And if we talk about the short term, and we're saying that the value or the relative yield or strategic value of some regions is going to drop, some of the regions are going to rise. And one of the ones that's going to rise is going to be the Middle East. The Middle East, because there are two main characteristics. First, they are, you know, one of the main producers of commodities on energy and raw materials. And second, the decisions they make are also going to have an impact on the possible strategies and the term of our strategies. So assessing the geopolitical perspective of climate change, not just from a European perspective, but also taking into account what's happening in the world, is essential to be able to make the right decisions. And that is why it is very important to have institutions such as Natigy supporting this process. We're talking about the Middle East, but we are going to have to analyze Latin America. We will have to analyze Northern Africa. We have, you know, a change and a huge shock of the geostrategic value of energy producing regions and energy consuming regions, and we have to do that being scientific and data-based. And last is that this is not just an empty debate. This has an impact on, you know, immediate impact, financial impact for companies and countries and the society. Well, the solutions we find are going to condition the sustainability and the prosperity of many of our societies. And talking about the sustainability and growth, it's also talking about the sustainability of our freedoms, our democratic framework, and our coexistence. Without having these economic and social perspective of integration. It's going to be very hard to analyze issues. And although specialists tend to isolate problems to be able to assess them, there needs to be a global view. And I believe that think tanks can have an important role to play. And I would like to finish being optimistic. The country, but not the country, the world, is a bit sad. The feeling is that we are at the verge of apocalypse. I am a son of enlightenment, and I believe that science and thinking can help us make the world better. And that's the idea, to have a happier world. And I believe there are reasons to think that not all is lost in Europe and not all is lost in Spain. Machado said that the past isn't dead, the present and the future haven't been written. And I believe that it is up to us to make decisions that will allow us to create the sustainability of growth and the success of climate change. And sometimes Spaniards don't take into account and the strength of our companies. Gonzalo Escribano wrote, Instituto, 10 contributions in Spain for, a safe alternative to Russia. And I recommend all of you to go and read it. But I would only read three out of the 10 ideas he mentions. The first of which is that Spain is an important part of the solution. Spain is able to contribute because it's less exposed to the short-term energy shock, and we have assets that we have to value. Second is that in the mid and long term, and this is always the ASEF part of the economics, if we make the right decisions, the contribution of Spain towards the energy autonomy of Europe is bigger or larger than in any other part of the economy. This is a growth vector and a prosperity vector of Spanish society. And third, there are companies in Spain that can build and make that transition effort to solve most immediate issues. And with that optimistic comment on our role, I mean, we can contribute more than some people recognize, as long as our Europeism and our legal framework still survive. And if that happens, I mean, I believe that that's a very important part of the debate we're going to have today. And I really want to thank all the speakers for being here with us today, because I am sure that all of you and all of us are going to learn a lot from that vision and to understand what is happening right now in the Middle East. Thank you very much, everybody, and I want to thank Naturgy once again for their support. And of course, you can count on us to keep on doing this, adding data and analysis to the debate so we can find solutions. Thank you. Thank you very much, Francisco and José Juan. We really hoped to have a debate that can help us understand the Middle East and the role that we have to play in energy transition and the impact for all of the region and the rest of the world. To start with the session, we are lucky to have a first speaker, Bassam Fatou. Bassam Fatou is the director of the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, and he will start with a presentation and showing the view of the Institute and his own view on the region that we are going to be dealing with today. Bassam is also a professor of the School of Oriental and African Studies, has published a lot of pieces of research on the oil pricing and energy transition and the economy of producing countries. He's also an advisor to many governments and companies. And luckily, Bassam, he's been the victim of air transportation issues. And so his flight was canceled last minute. And so, unluckily, he couldn't make it, but we've been able to organize him being here online. And Bassam, thank you very much.
For us, it's a real pleasure having you here virtually with us in this session. And please, the floor is yours.
First of all, thank you, Manuel, for the very kind introduction. And I'm really delighted to be joining you today. And I would like to thank the organizers for the very kind invitation and for this opportunity. I would really have very much loved to join you in person, but the airline had different plans and my flight was canceled. But hopefully there will be other opportunities. So the title of my talk today is the energy transition in the Middle East. And of course, this is a very broad topic. And I'll try to break it down into a few parts. The first one, I will highlight some of the features of the energy transition, which I think are quite important and could impact the Middle East oil and gas producers. And then I will discuss some of the strategies that the Middle East oil and gas exporters can adopt to confront the potential impacts of the transformations in the energy sector on their economies. Finally, I will conclude with a few thoughts on the geopolitics of the energy transition and the importance of avoiding some broad general conclusions that sometimes we hear, especially when it comes to the Middle East. But before doing that, let me start with one observation, and that is the fact that oil rents have brought massive economic benefits to oil and gas exporters. And that actually has been reflected in most socioeconomic and development indicators. Though this has happened to varying degrees, you know, some countries have benefited much more than others from the oil rents. But at the same time, one has to recognize that the heavy reliance on oil revenues has also created its own economic and institutional drawbacks. For instance, the instability and volatility of oil revenues have contributed to macroeconomic instability and very volatile economic growth. Also, there's a wide literature which shows that the distribution of oil rents have contributed to weak institutional environment and many economic distortions. For instance, this includes a weak private sector, which is heavily dependent on the government, very rigid labor markets, wide sort of inefficiencies, subsidies, which tend to distort production and consumption decisions. And all of these have been reflected in a relatively weak economic growth and declining GDP per capita over time, especially as the populations have been increasing. Now, these challenges are going to become much more pronounced as the prospects for oil demand are becoming more uncertain due to the energy transition and decarbonization policies. Now, I don't have any demand projections myself, but I would like to make a few observations when it comes to peak oil demand and the energy transition. The first one is that the oil demand projections are extremely sensitive to the underlying assumptions of the model. These very much depend on the assumptions you make about economic growth, about population growth, about the transformation you see in the transport sector, and the global carbon taxes, and these are just few examples. And actually changing these assumptions, one can push forward or backward the peak by decades. The other observation that I would like to make as well is that it's very important to understand what is the purpose of the exercise, because sometimes some people are referring to forecasting and some people are referring to backcasting. What do I mean by backcasting? Basically, people assume that we are going to reach our net zero targets by 2050, and then they start working their way back. And of course, there are different paths that you can work your way back. And that's why quite important is that when we're looking at this projection, it's very important to understand the purpose of the exercise, whether it's forecasting or whether it's backcasting. Another observation I would say is that most of the scenarios predict that there's going to be a unique global peak, and then after that, oil demand will decline sharply after reaching this unique peak. Now, in reality, we could see actually other types of scenarios where oil demand could plateau for a long period of time, or we could see actually multiple peaks. So oil demand could decline in certain years and increase in other years, depending on many factors. So this idea that we're going to have only one peak and after that oil demand is going to decline fast after that peak I think that makes projections, modeling projection, quite simpler, but the world can turn out to be different. And of course, there is no consensus on many of the underlying assumptions. Some of the projections are based on historical trends, which tend to show that fast transition in the energy system has rarely happened, whether other projections are based on the assumption that this transition is quite unique because it involves fighting climate change and it's going to be driven by government policy and technological advancements. Now, I would say, I would like to just mention a few features of the energy transition, which I think are quite important in the Middle East context, because it will shape their energy policies looking forward. And I would like to mention a few of these. First of all, that the speed of the energy transition is highly uncertain. The second one is that the transition will not be uniform across the globe. The third one is that transition will not be linear. It could be disruptive. There could be setbacks. And the final point, which I would like to emphasize, especially towards the end of my talk, is that there is no single transition path. There are many transition paths out there. However, regardless of the speeds, the impacts of the transition are already being felt. The perceptions and players' behaviors are shifting much, much faster than actual changes in the energy mix. And this is already shaping the energy industry on some key decisions. For instance, if you look in terms of finance, this is the energy transition and perceptions of the changes and the transformation associated with the energy transition are already affecting investors' risk preferences. And this is going to impact financing costs, the availability of finance for hydrocarbon projects, and also the investments going into the sector. It's also already altering the behavior of many players, including the international energy companies, which are adapting their strategies. They are incorporating climate-related objectives into their strategies. They are reducing the share of oil assets in their portfolios. Some of them are increasing the share of gas and renewables, and many of them have been announcing ambitious targets to reach net zero emissions by 2050. Now, when it comes to oil exporters, especially those from the Middle East, they face graver challenges than the international energy companies. And that's for a couple of reasons. The first one is that the proved reserve to production ratios extend for multiple decades. So they face the real challenge of how to monetize a much larger reserve base than international energy companies. So for instance, if you look at international energy companies, the proved reserve to production is measured in years, whereas for the national oil companies and for the countries, this is measured in decades. The other reason as well is that the risk of losses in export revenues could disrupt their socioeconomic well-being, given the high reliance of their economies on oil revenues. So really the key question to me is, what adaptation strategies should oil exporters pursue, given that there are domestic economic and political constraints, there is an energy transition which is changing the prospects of oil demand, but whose speed is uncertain and whose impact is not uniform across the globe, while at the same time we're seeing perceptions, behaviors, and policies changing quite fast. And of course, one of those strategies is to diversify away from the oil and gas sector. And that's what many consultancies and many international organizations tend to recommend. But I would argue that there are real challenges to realize meaningful diversification, particularly fiscal diversification. This requires a massive economic transformation. This requires serious extensive economic reforms, labor market reforms, private sector reforms, human capital enhancement. And there is really uncertainty about how quickly or even whether such extensive economic and institutional reforms can be implemented in most oil and gas exporting countries. Also, one has to emphasize that the oil and gas sector remain very profitable and still enjoy very high margins. And governments can leverage on oil and gas revenues to ease the pains of the structural reforms which are needed to diversify their economic base. Also, I would make another argument as well, that the reduced investment flows into the oil and gas sector can cause supply to fall faster than demand, and this could result in higher margin, at least for short periods of time. So exiting too early from such an established strategic sector deprives the country of an important source of income and a key source of competitive advantage. So that's why perhaps one needs to refine the question a little bit more. If diversifying from the oil and gas sector is suboptimal for the reasons that I mentioned, and it cannot be achieved at a rapid pace, then the question perhaps could be how to enhance the competitiveness and increase the resilience of the hydrocarbon sector in a world that is transitioning towards net zero emissions. And here, the oil and gas exporters face some choices. And one of these is that many of the oil and gas exports, especially those in the Middle East, can compete on cost and actually can take measures to improve the efficiency of production and lower these costs even further. Some of the oil and gas exporters actually can pursue faster monetization and extraction strategies. And that is what is known in the literature as the green paradox. Now, all of these strategies have their limitations because the lack of fiscal diversification and the high social cost of production acts as a constraint on this strategy. Increasing supply in face of slowing demand would result in much lower revenues, at least in the shorter term. In the longer term, we could see the exit of many producers, and some of the Middle Eastern producers can benefit from the exit of those high-cost producers or those lower-cost producers that are not able to increase productive capacity for a variety of reasons. So that's one aspect that one needs to take into account. The other is that some importing countries may decide to implement high carbon taxes, and this will create a wedge between the revenue generated by oil and gas exporters and the revenue generated by consuming countries, with the consuming countries capturing a big part of the rent as they introduce those taxes. So this is one strategy that oil and gas exporters can pursue, faster monetization, but this has its limitation. The other strategy that oil and gas exporters can pursue is to try to diversify into products and exports closely related to the hydrocarbon sector and energy-intensive industries. Those are industries which those oil and gas exporters have some competitive advantage in. I'm talking about petrochemicals, steel, cement, and fertilizers, and other energy-intensive industries. And this could create actually higher value-added products and can provide a hedge against price volatility, and it can lead to the developments of sectors which have technological spillovers. But again, heavy industrialization into energy-intensive industries increases the domestic emissions of greenhouse gases, and it will make it much more difficult for these countries to meet their climate targets. And of course, one has to take into account the response of importing countries. For instance, importers can develop policies to account for carbon content of final goods, and they could decide to apply border carbon adjustment measures. And again, this will have the impact of capturing part of the rent away from the producers towards to the consumers. So that is why one of the arguments that I've been making is that producers, whether oil and gas, need to ensure that their production processes and core hydrocarbon products can compete also on the emissions front. So the competition should not only be on the cost front, but it also should be done also on the emission reduction. And that actually involves reducing emission in the production process, scope one and scope two, and in the consumption of gas and petroleum products derived from crude and natural gas, basically what people sometimes refer to as scope three emissions. And I would argue that some oil and gas exporters are in a relatively better position compared to other producers, especially those in the Middle East, they are in a much better position because of the low carbon content of their crude and because of the heavy investment in infrastructure, which some of the countries have implemented in reducing gas flaring and methane emission. And the real challenge to me lies in reducing emission from the consumption of their final petroleum products. Now, one of the things that those countries could do within the energy sphere, of course, is investment in renewables. And this is likely to create a new sectors which will have some competitive advantage because the MENA countries, the Middle East countries, they have rich solar resources and have rich wind resources. And at the same time, also, they can integrate renewables within the existing hydrocarbon infrastructure, and this would allow them to reduce emissions in their production and the extraction process. And actually, this would allow them also to increase oil and gas export potential without increasing productive capacity, because this will reduce their demand for hydrocarbon products. But again, you know, one needs to emphasize that the margins in renewables cannot fully substitute for the rents generated by the hydrocarbon sector. So this concept that you are going to convert a hydrocarbon exporter and switch them to a renewable exporter, and that could be happen easily, I think that's a wishful thinking. And that's why it's very important to emphasize that the exporters, in addition to investing in renewables, they need to decarbonize their core activities and core exports to compete in a carbon-constrained world. And that is why I've been emphasizing the importance of certain technologies, and particularly the deployment of carbon capture, utilization, and storage, which is needed actually to help the world achieve the goal of net zero emission. And that actually will enable also the oil and gas exporter to be part of the mix, especially that, you know, so far, if you look at most of the projections, they're still expecting oil and gas to remain part of the energy mix. Also, for some energy intensive, hard to abate sectors such as steel and cement, technical options to reduce emissions without CCS are currently very limited. And most of the IPCC scenarios also assume a very important role for CCS. Otherwise, it will not be possible to limit the temperature rise to 1.5 degrees. Now, why I emphasize the CCS? Because I think this is a very important dimension related to oil and gas exporters. Because this is a climate mitigation actions through which some oil and gas exporters could establish a competitive advantage. And this is due to the fact that their natural resources, particularly geological storage capacities, their access to depleted hydrocarbon reservoir, and their existing infrastructure. All of these are important factors that oil and gas exporters can exploit to build competitive advantage in these sectors. Also in the technical resources, because they have massive expertise in subsurface technology. And also the deployment of the CCS can provide an opportunity for them to contribute to climate change action. But at the same time, as I mentioned, to try to monetize the reserves in a more sustainable way and retain the competitiveness if they're, of their oil and gas sectors and energy intensive industries in a carbon constrained world. And despite the strategic interest for oil and gas exporters to lead on the carbon sink mitigation strategies, what we see is that most of the CCS projects are located in OECD countries. And from an oil exporter, I have always argued that investment in CCUS lowers the returns compared to existing strategy, which is fine, but at the same time, it increases resilience. So you might end up with lower returns, but actually it can increase the resilience of your sector. And not leading on the CCUS fronts could risk undermining their competitive position. But at the same time, shifting the costs to oil and gas exporters alone, I don't think this is viable, especially if the costs are too high. Because after all, the producing countries, especially those in the Middle East, are likely to be most affected by the transition. And there's going to be a lot of competition for limited funds to try to diversify their economies. So that is why it's very important to develop burden sharing mechanisms, which allows a much more inclusive path. And that will include that we think outside the box into new instruments, such as the wellhead carbon taxes, CCA clubs, creating carbon storage units. But this requires harmonization of policies. This requires strong cooperation, either on a multilateral framework or a bilateral framework. And that basically turns me to a very key point that I emphasized in the beginning, is that there are going to be various transition paths, and this is going to depend very much on the starting points, the core competitive advantages of these countries and the existing assets that they hold. Insisting on a single path could delay the transition, because it will not enable the use of the technical and financial resources of the producers. It may perpetuate non-cooperative behavior on negotiations and increase the cost of the transitions. And that's why it's very important to provide frameworks that don't discriminate against certain technologies or fuels and allow for technologies to compete. But it also allows that developing burden-sharing mechanism between importers and exporters and integrate these into multilateral and bilateral frameworks. And what is really quite encouraging is that we see many of the Middle East oil and gas exporters becoming very active, playing very active role in climate change negotiations. But one also needs to recognize as well that oil and gas exporting countries need to show leadership in mitigation technologies and decarbonization. And that leadership should be on the technological front, on the investment framework, on the business model, and push for frameworks that promote burden sharing mechanisms to offset part of the cost and shield their economies. I do appreciate that this strategy is costly and risky, but so are the alternative technologies. And now let me conclude with just one couple of observations. Many are of the view that the Middle East oil and gas exporters will emerge as the definite losers from the energy transition. And this is based on the premise that oil demand will decline sharply. And as a result of that, we're going to see the erosion of oil rents. And also the importance of oil and gas as a strategic commodity will fall. And this is, and as a result of that, we're going to see the geopolitical position of the MENA oil exporters also declining. And in that world, according to this view, we're likely to see oil and gas exporters engaging in a fierce competition for market share in a declining market. And this is going to also lower margins and revenues. And of course, given the undiversified economic structure of oil exporters and rigidity of their government spending, this will result in economic disruptions and instability, and that will destroy the social fabric of these countries. I would argue that this analysis is quite deterministic, it's quite simplistic, and actually it does not help in the way we think about the energy transition. And I would just like to make to conclude with few observations to why I think this is the case. First of all, MENA oil and gas exporters are not a homogeneous group, and their resilience and core sources of competitive advantage vary tremendously within the region. There are some countries that have the assets, they have the ability to compete in the energy transition world. The other reason as well is that the energy transition can cause dislocations in energy markets that the Middle East exporters or some of them can benefit from and can exploit. And the third point, which is, I think is very, very important, is that some of the key oil and gas exporters are not standing still, and they are evolving and responding to the challenges that the energy transition may bring. So the concept of losers and winners in the energy transition is not useful in the MENA context. I think, you know, we need to recognize that the energy transition will pose real challenges to MENA oil and gas exporters, but the focus should be on whether MENA exporters are prepared to deal with these challenges, whether they are increasing their resilience to the potential disruptions, and whether they are adopting strategies that they could help confront, they help them confront some of these challenges. And I would argue, just to conclude, that some of the MENA oil exporters are in a very good position and a much better position than others, and maybe even in a position to benefit from the transformation associated with the energy transition, and actually can play an important role in that process. So with that, I conclude, and thank you very much for the kind invitation and for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Bassam. A real impressive presentation from your side and about what the energy transition means in the Middle East countries, and the implication for the rest of the world with these great challenges we are facing, as is the climate change, sustainability, and security of supply. We are now going to move to the next part of the seminar, where we will have a debate with exceptional participants, real true experts, not only in the world of energy, but also in the world of security, and specifically in the area we are in, the region we are focusing on today. First of all, we have with us Mariana Liakopoulou. She's Markets and Policy Associate in the European Union Liaison Office of the European Federation of Energy Traders, and she also served as Research Analyst in Energy Security with the NATO Association of Canada. It's also with us Noura Mansouri. Nora is a research fellow at the King Abdullah Petroleum Studies and Research Center. Is also a research affiliate at MIT and an expert at the World Energy Council. She has many publications on climate change and sustainability, and sustainable energy transitions, and she is the author of the book Greening the Black Gold, Saudi Arabia's Quest for Clean Energy. Nora is also a founder of, and board member of the Saudi Association of Energy Economics. Here with us is also Chloe Berger. Chloe is a faculty advisor and researcher at the NATO Defense College. Her research work focuses mainly on security, political and social economic issues in the MENA region and the implications for NATO. And finally, Carlos Gasco, who is since 2019 the Energy Policy Executive Director of the Department of Energy of the United Arab Emirates. Carlos is an economist and has held various positions in both private companies and public administration in Spain. Of course, all this excellent panel of participants will have to be moderated for another great expert, as Gonzalo Escribano is. Gonzalo directs the Energy and Climate Program of Elcano Royal Institute and is a full professor of Economic Policy in the Department of Applied Economics of the UNED. His research agenda focuses on international energy issues, geopolitics, geoeconomics of energy, energy security, renewable energies, and the interaction of energy resources with economic development of producing countries. In short, there cannot be a better person to moderate this great debate. I indicate to all of you that all people who's connected that can send the questions through the platform, you are connected. And here, the people in the auditorium, through the cards that you received at the entrance of the auditorium, that will be collected by the organization if you wish. Thank you very much, all of you, again for joining us and being here with us. For us, it's a real pleasure and honor. And Gonzalo, it's your turn.
Okay, thank you so much, Manuel, and thank you, Rafael, and the Naturgy Foundation. It's always a pleasure to be here with you. Thank you so much for making this possible, and thank you so much to these great panelists for making it to be with us. I'm going to try to very, very quickly start with the discussions. We don't miss, and we are very time and energy efficient. So I will pose a round of questions to the speakers, and you can answer whatever you want to my questions, to other people's questions, or whatever you want to see. So let's have a frank and open discussion. And I will start immediately with Dr. Mansouri. Nora, may I start?
Yes.
Okay. So I would like you, and I will pose mainly the same question to Carlos. Looking from Saudi Arabia and from a more general regional perspective, how do you, Nora, from Saudi Arabia, and you, Carlos, from the Emirates, how do you see the energy transition from your region?
Thank you very much, Gonzalo, and I'd like to take the opportunity to thank you for the kind invitation. It's a pleasure for me to be here. So thank you for this important question. In fact, the energy transition in the region, and especially in Saudi Arabia and the Gulf, have started a long time ago. In fact, Saudi Arabia has showcased its environmental stewardship since the 70s, when it has decided to stop flaring the gas and instead has founded an industry around it, around hydrocarbons and specifically petrochemicals. But most notably, Saudi Arabia has announced its net zero target by 2060, just before COP26, and has doubled its national determined contributions to 278 million tons of CO2 by 2030. So Saudi Arabia is very much serious about the energy transition and is creating this roadmap towards net zero by establishing so many initiatives. In fact, there's been a lot of announcements around these initiatives, including the Saudi Green Initiatives of planting 10 billion trees across Saudi Arabia, the Middle East Green Initiative for planting 40 billion trees across the region. This is in addition to its ambitions for including 50% renewable energy in its energy mix by 2030, and a number of giga projects that will help in the economic diversification of the country, and this will help in achieving mitigation co-benefits for the climate. We have the blueprint of Vision 2030 that has sustainability at the heart of it, and environmental sustainability, and these giga projects, including the future city of NEOM, which plans to use 100% renewable energy and plans to be the home for the world's largest green hydrogen, to produce 650 tons of green hydrogen daily. And we already have prospective importers of this green hydrogen. Saudi Arabia also exported blue ammonia to Japan. It shipped, it was the world's first shipment of blue ammonia. So this is evident of using hydrocarbons in a clean way and burning it in a clean way. There has also been a lot of achievements in the Red Sea development projects, the Amala project, which keeps sustainability and regenerative even industries in the tourism industry, blue carbon economy, and many other initiatives that keeps the environmental sustainability at the heart of it.
You have to read their papers. I mean, all these people here, you have to read their papers, because they got really, look in their web pages of their institution, because there are really, really wonderful papers, especially you got several ones.
Thank you, Gonzalo.
Very worthy to read. I'm going immediately now to Chloe, and we change a little. I mean, coming from NATO Defense College, Chloe, what will be your personal assessment, and I'm expecting, I'm waiting for your disclaimer probably, what will be your personal assessment of the Ukraine crisis for the Gulf and from the Middle East region on your strategic assessment?
So thank you very much. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. I'm really pleased to be here. And so, institutional classical disclaimer that, of course, I'm representing, my own views, not the alliance or NATO Defense College actually views. So having said that, what is, I would say, the impact of the Ukraine war on the Gulf countries? I would say that from a regional perspective, they are probably better placed than other countries in the MENA region. So they have, I would say, from huge wheat imports, but at the same time, huge reserves, small population. If you compare, I would say, this ratio with Egypt or Tunisia, they are definitely, a better place. So this is it from, I would say, a domestic perspective. At the same time, what I can see is the fact that we have European countries trying to reduce their dependency vis-a-vis Russia. And so this implies that they are looking for alternative, providers of energy supplies. So you have, of course, North Africa, but you have also traditional, partners in the Gulf. And so this will probably, rise, new security challenges or reinvigorate, the tensions that we have seen. There are pre-existing tensions in the Gulf. And so this will, increase, security related challenges to, of course, the securitization of shipping routes. You have also all the protection of the, production infrastructures. And so we have seen that cybersecurity is already something that is really, an ongoing part of the conflictuality in the region. So this raised the question of who is providing security guarantees to the Gulf countries. And so we have seen with this war that obviously there are some, geopolitical shifts. The Gulf countries have made very clearly that they are not ready to align, on the West or on Russia. They have developed their own, path, and they are very keen in maintaining, this, kind of balanced position. And so the problem is that to which extent, the geopolitical challenges will force those countries to choose. And so one paradox that this war in Ukraine is actually posing is the fact that we have countries that are encouraged to consider, strategic paths and investments to develop, more sustainable, energy mix. And at the same time, we have a crisis that is forcing European countries to find, quick fix solution for our, I would say, supplies now. So we have countries that are basically compelled to make very quick decisions on structural, I would say, options. And so this is also things that, of course, will have implications on the security side. And so I was referring to security guarantees, to which extent the US will keep being, I would say, the main security provider to those countries. This is something to be seen, to which extent those countries will renegotiate, I would say, the transactional relations they have with the US and have, I would say, alternative options like Russia, but maybe more than Russia, China. And so we all understand that, you know, this will, of course, at a point, maybe collide with, you know, the US, I would say, strategy towards Indo-Pacific, the Indo-Pacific area. So all these components have to be taken into consideration when, I would say, the security challenges are at stake for the Gulf countries. And of course, we have in the region, probably we will see an increase of instability, having in mind, you know, domestic challenges raised by food insecurity connected to Ukrainian and Russian exports of wheat. And so increased domestic instability in the world neighborhood will have, of course, implications for Gulf countries. We have a time where, you know, Gulf countries will be also more compelled to help stabilizing, I would say, the neighborhoods. And so this is all challenges that, I mean, the Gulf countries will have to solve in, I would say, a separate or bilateral, you know, path or as a GCC. And so this is also a very good question, to which extent this crisis will help the GCC countries, I would say, close the chapter about their own divides, or on the contrary, will exacerbate, I would say, those divides. This is still to be seen.
That's fascinating. I see the next NATO summit here in Madrid, they will get a lot of homework to do, probably on the energy matter too.
Yes, definitely. Definitely.
Okay, we move now to Carlos. And Carlos, I will ask you exactly the same question that I asked to Nora. What is the regional perspective on the energy transition from the Emirates? But in your case, you can have a dual perspective. Also, not only how do you see it, but how to explain this to we Europeans?
Right. Oh, thank you, Gonzalo, very much. And thank you to the Naturgy Foundation and to Real Instituto Elcano for having me here. It's just amazing to actually be here today discussing, sharing some thoughts, hopefully sharing some light as well. Just like Chloe, I also need to, you know, say my own little disclaimer. All my opinions are personal. I am not here in the representation of the official position of the Department of Energy of Abu Dhabi, but I am here, obviously, with my experience and everything that I can provide to the debate in an open, transparent, and hopefully interesting way. I would take advantage of that disclaimer to be a little bit provocative for the sake of the discussion, for the sake of the debate. Just, I would like everybody to think that you could fly, that you could go away, because what we do here in this part of the world tends to be, you know, quite robust from a technical, from an analytic point of view, but it's also narrow. The one thing that I've learned in the last 4 years when I've been working outside of Europe is that the world is a lot bigger than Europe and much bigger than Spain. So just go somewhere else and put yourself in the shoes of someone in the Middle East, in the shoes of someone in a developing nation, maybe in India, maybe in China, maybe somewhere in Latin America or in Africa, and think of the debate today, the energy transition. The energy transition is great. Everybody likes the energy transition. The Germans had this Energiewende, which is we need to move, we have to change. But is it a European issue? Is it a Western priority, or is it a global priority? And when we look at what it wants to achieve and what is happening, we need to think twice, I think. Because the energy transition is about sustainability, security of supply, and affordability. And if we look at what happens, and now put yourself, as I said, in the shoes of someone who is 7,000 kilometers away from here and looks at these three things. Emissions are increasing. We are already above the emissions levels, pre-pandemic levels. So that is not working, at least not as much as it should. Maybe it's working compared to what would happen if, but the reality is we are above. The second is security of supply, energy security. We just realized that we have a massive issue, right? And it costs money, which links to the third thing, the affordability. So we put all these efforts in our policies, in our strategies, in our language, in the corporate behaviors, in the government behaviors, everything, and what we collect. I'm not saying that we're failing, but I'm saying that we're not succeeding. Let's say we could do better, right? So the Middle East is right in the middle between the East and the West. And at the same time, the Middle East is providing hydrocarbons, you know, to the economies of the East and the West. So, and at the same time, the Middle East is witnessing, like everybody, why these things in the energy policy, in the energy transition are failing or not succeeding, at least. And I would say, you know, as I said, to be a bit provocative, I think we think, or it could be said, that there is a lack of realism in the definition of the policies of the energy transition. We've been speaking about renewables and all of these green transition, but we didn't realize that we also needed the hydrocarbons to do part of the job. And, you know, it just suddenly we emerge from the pandemic and the supply is rigid and the demand skyrockets and the prices spike. So that's the one thing. The second thing is, if it's so important and if the problems are the emissions related to the hydrocarbons, why don't we take them seriously? Why don't we tax, or why don't we price the emissions? Why don't we phase out the technologies? If the problem is global, why don't we help the economies? They cannot pursue their own goals the way they have to fight the global problem. And this is seen by the world. And the third issue is, are the technologies there for us? We speak about things for 2050, but we don't know really how we're going to achieve them. You know, energy storage is fundamental. Do we have the ability? Is the energy transition a mining transition? Because we will need a lot of minerals and materials to build that storage, to make this energy transition happen, but are there for us? And if they are, where are they? Are we substituting some of the energy dependency from a mineral dependency? Is this electrostates? Are they actually mining states? And lastly, we put faith in things which are to some extent still unproven. Hydrogen. I mean, it looks great on paper, but when you go and speak to an airline and say you have to fly your airplanes with hydrogen, and then this is, well, I don't think I can. And maybe I can technically, but can I afford it? When you say I will, you know, excess capacity in the summer or in the winter, depending on the jurisdiction, I will store it in the form of hydrogen and then deliver seasonal storage, which is what we need for the renewables and all that, with an efficiency of 15%. So that we need to take the air, CO2 from the atmosphere directly if we need to succeed, but we still don't know how to do it, or maybe we do, but it's not affordable. So we need to recognize that the energy transition is fundamental, it's important, but it's not easy or cheap. And if we don't come to terms to that, we will still run around in circles. And this is what is seen from the Middle East, but I think this is what is seen from everywhere. And this is what some people out there, not Europeans, call the Western hypocrisy. Because we do all these things, we have this language, but at the same time, we don't do other things. But we tell everybody how they should, let's say, behave. So now back to the original question, the Middle East. I can speak, and this was trying to answer just your second part of the question. Okay. But the first one is, what does the energy transition mean for the Middle East and in particular for the UAE? Well, it means business. It means opportunities. It means change. It means diversification. It means moving from an old paradigm into a new paradigm. But, this is a very big but, the Middle East produces the cleanest, most competitive oil and gas that there is anywhere. It will continue to sell these products for decades to come. What it means is the uncertainty of not if you will sell them, because it's been said before, some players with higher costs will have to be pushed out of a shrinking cake. But how much money will you make? This is a commodity. So small price or differential will generate an important impact on your revenues or cost differential. So that is what it means. It means volatility, it means uncertainty, and it means a challenge to move from the already volatile oil markets or hydrocarbon markets into a more resilient, more stable, more predictable economy. And that means instead of focusing on the molecules or the electrons, focusing on the industrial processes, focusing on the real economy and using those competitive advantages as an input for that, and the generation of added value, which is the quest of the region. That's what we're working on. That is the primary driver. We don't want to make in the UAE the cheapest molecule of green hydrogen. We want to take out the most value of that molecule in an industrial process. I would rather have a, not me personally, I would rather have a factory to do green aluminium, green steel, or batteries or cars made with locally sourced competitive hydrogen than fighting with someone for a market share of a potential future hydrogen market. That is really a completely different paradigm. So I think, just to finalize, because maybe I'm speaking a bit too much, I think the energy transition is for real. Both Saudi and the UAE are compromised to a net zero future, 2050 in the case of the UAE. We just approved in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi interim renewable and clean energy targets for 2035. 60% of all the electricity will be clean. There is a huge effort in evolving the energy mix, but there is also a huge effort in realizing that it's not just about the investment in the electricity or the energy sector, is evolving the economy to a new, let's say, more resilient, less volatile future. And this is the focus of the area.
Thank you so much, Carlos. Very, very comprehensive. I will turn now to Mariana. Mariana has worked a lot on carbon markets in the EU and the Gulf and linkages on that, among many other issues. But on that, I would like to ask you, what can you tell us, Mariana? What potential, what linkages can we establish between eventual carbon markets in the Gulf? How would that work?
Yeah, so thanks a lot, Gonzalo, and thanks a lot to Real Elcano Instituto and to Naturgy Foundation for the kind invitation. It's very nice to be with you here today. So let me start by saying something that I've written before. I think that when it comes to carbon pricing, the Middle East can actually benefit from the design and scope of an inclusive cap and trade system, such as the EU emissions trading system, for two reasons. First, for the establishment of national cap and trade systems emulating the EU ETS, and second, for the prospective establishment of a regional carbon pricing scheme emulating the EU ETS and linked with it. Now, why is this important? To basically offer the Middle East and North Africa region a cost-effective way out of awkward measures of the sort of a carbon border adjustment mechanism. Because at the end of the day, putting a price on the carbon content of imports will constitute a problem for exports of oil, exports of gas, and other energy-intensive exports from the region to Europe. Now, what I would like to focus and I would like to discuss with you here today are the reasons why these efforts have been unsuccessful so far in the region. And I would like to start by saying that carbon pricing is unfortunately largely unfavored in predominant sectors of these economies, such as oil and gas upstream operations, petrochemicals, refining, to name a few. Of course, always in the potential in the fear of a potential economic detriment. Now, industrialization in the Middle East and North Africa region, and even efforts towards the region's economic diversification are primarily driven by energy-intensive industries. And why am I saying that? I'm saying this because energy-intensive industries run the risk of becoming less competitive should carbon pricing be implemented. And another reason has to do with the persisting energy subsidies that we see in the region, which offset carbon pricing. But here I would like to quote research by Paul Vanson, actually, highlighting that fossil fuel subsidies, including through electricity prices, have already been gradually reduced in the region, coming down from $400 billion in 2012 in the MENA alone. And of course, this process has been, needless to say, overall difficult to carry out due to the financial impact on society. However, the greater the penetration of renewable energies, which do not need subsidization per se, for example, tenders for photovoltaic systems in the UAE that we've seen, then the less the need for state support, at least beyond the, you know, an initial period for markets to kickstart. And a third, perhaps, reason making implementation even more challenging is, in my opinion, the prominent economic feature of state-owned enterprises, at least in the GCC, energy and heavy industry sectors. And here I would like to include monopoly state oil and utility firms. So this kind of increases the risk for political lobbying against carbon pricing. So finally, the momentum for collective action is sort of hindered by the, I would say, possibility that if a GCC country, if a Middle Eastern country unilaterally legislates for and applies a carbon mitigation strategy on its own, then you're going to have joint venture partners and non-state controlled energy intensive industries fleeing to a neighboring country with less stringent regulations. So that would be the three reasons, at least from where I stand. And for this reason, implementation of consistent carbon pricing strategies per GCC country and collective action are critical for the establishment of a regional carbon trading scheme. And now this process, and I would like to conclude with that, is largely contingent on the momentum of implementation of the newly revised Article 6 of the Paris Agreement on rules for cooperative implementation of carbon targets. And at the same time, it is also important to take into account the European debate, and that is that the EU emissions trading system is also subject to further development under the Fit for 55 package through its proposed expansion and the establishment of a second emissions trading system for transport and buildings. There is also here the additional parameter on voluntary carbon markets that I know that Gonzalo, you and I have discussed. I don't know if I have a bit of time. It's up to you. You're the manager.
Go for it.
Okay. And I would like to point out to you the complexity entailed when it comes to VCMs, the complexity when it comes to creating greenhouse gas verified claims for methane emissions from oil imports, due to the complexity given the different oil grades, their transportation, and the different refining processes, as noted by our colleague at the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, Adim Sirovic, in his very informative paper. And this is particularly important for the purchase, say, by, I don't know, a Mediterranean refinery of Middle East crudes, in terms of the diverging refinery margins of those crudes, and the adjustment of those margins based on the underlying carbon price. And the same amount of complexity is entailed in the certification of carbon removals from technology-based or nature-based CCUS solutions, which are going to drive decarbonization of gas produced in the MENA region, as Bassam also pointed out. In this case, as you know, Europe intends, or perhaps you know, intends to put forward a regulatory framework for the certification of those technologies by the end of the year, We as IFED at least hope that this framework will ensure commonality of certification instruments at the EU level and will also incentivize deployment of all carbon dioxide removal technologies as soon as declared commercially viable. And I think that's also a very important parameter to point out when it comes to our relations with the MENA countries.
Sure. Thank you, Mariana. Thanks a lot. Let's go back to Nora. Nora, you gave us a general perspective, but I would like to go you to go more into the details, like, for instance, about all this about the circular carbon economy, all the Saudi climate targets, all the energy transition ambitions. What can you tell us with more detail on those issues?
Thank you, Gonzalo. So the circular carbon economy was proposed by Saudi Arabia during the 2020 G20 summit in Riyadh, and it was endorsed by all the G20 countries. The what the circular carbon economy contributes to climate mitigation is that it provides a transition towards low carbon economy in a very holistic and inclusive and pragmatic way. So it shifts the discussion really from talking about energy sources to shifting and talking about managing the emissions from these energy sources. And it's something that was touched upon by earlier in the opening remarks by the president of Naturgy when he talked about the customized energy transition. And it was also reiterated by our colleague Bassam Fattouh from Oxford Institute when he discussed the importance of keeping the options open in the energy transition and not forcing a single transition pathway. So the circular carbon economy is based on the four pathways, the four R's: reduce, reuse, recycle, and remove carbon and greenhouse gas emissions. So it provides so many options for countries based on their national circumstances, based on their national endowments. So every country can customize their energy transition based on its energy security needs, its economic plans, and its current energy mix and going from where it is today and where it needs to go in the future. So technologies such as carbon capture and utilization and storage, which was discussed heavily today, is an important technology as it allows the continued participation of the continued use of hydrocarbons, which is, according to all the forecast, is going to be increasingly important energy source, but it also more importantly allows the participation of the hard to abate sectors that are locked in hydrocarbons to participate in this energy transition. So it really highlights the importance of not discriminating against a certain set of energy technologies or energy sources, as this will have many implications. This was also discussed earlier. It will increase the cost of the transition. It will make the energy transition abrupt and not as smooth, and so on and so forth. And the hard-to-abate sector specifically make up over a third of the global CO2 emissions. So not allowing these sectors to participate in the energy transition is a grave is a grave issue. So technologies like carbon capture, utilization, and storage need to be invested in, and also hydrogen, for instance, which we see as a cross-cutting technology in its different colors. Blue hydrogen using CCS. And green hydrogen using renewables and other colors. So it's important to look at hydrogen as clean hydrogen and also not discriminate based on color. The circular carbon economy also allows countries to define their own targets, their own NDCs, and their own energy transition at the pace that is reasonable for these countries. So for Saudi Arabia, since you asked, Saudi Arabia is using the circular carbon economy approach to meet its net zero target. So in this map towards, this roadmap towards net zero, it has so many initiatives along these circular carbon economy approach. And the deployment of CCE in the region is also something important, and in the Gulf countries, the oil exporting countries more specifically, as it helps hydrocarbons industry to transition towards carbon circularity. And this is important because we don't look at the emissions coming out of the hydrocarbons and in energy emissions in general as only a negative externality, but we look at it as an important feedstock for the industry, which is something that Carlos touched upon earlier in the discussion. So how can we use these as raw materials, as important feedstock for the hydrocarbons industry towards circularity for a win-win situation between, you know, this classic delicate balance of balancing the SDGs and meeting the sustainable development goals, specifically SDG 7 on energy access and SDG 13 on climate action. So how can we balance between the two towards a more inclusive, sustainable energy transition?
Great, awesome. Very clear. Thank you so much for that. Let's go now to Chloe. I got a question for you on, you partially touched upon it, but if you could elaborate a bit more on which impact do you think the current energy security crisis we're undergoing in Europe and the way it will unfold will impact NATO allies' energy security policies or strategies or perceptions?
So I think that there is a dangerous trend. This is my personal view again. This securitized approach to energy policy. I think that we today, I mean, obviously the key of a reduced dependency vis-a-vis Russia lies in the South. Okay, so what we call in NATO or for transatlantic security, this Grand Southern Periphery that, you know, ranges from I would say roughly Sahel to Afghanistan, Pakistan. And so, of course, I mean, European countries are heavily dependent on Russia's, I would say, supplies, especially for countries like Germany, Italy. This is super obvious. So now the question is that, how do you, I would say, mitigate this dependency? So you are looking for a new, I would say, providers. So Algeria is one, Egypt is another. You have also in the Eastern Med, I would say, you know, promising prospects. But all, I would say, those options are bringing to the table a lot of geopolitical rivalries and complexities. And so this is not, you know, it's not because we are looking at the Med, this is disconnected from what is happening in the Gulf. Look at what are today, I would say, foreign projection or the ambitions of some of the Gulf countries in Northern Africa. We have, an increasing pattern of, you know, a Gulf governance of the Mediterranean basin. So this is something that is cannot be solved out, on a short term. The problem is that we are looking for short-term solutions. At the same time, we have countries that have, capacity to increase probably their production, but to a certain level. I'm not sure that by the summer, when we will try to, renew our stocks, those countries will be able to fill all the gaps. And so this implies that we invest, and when I'm saying we, I'm saying Europeans, we invest, you know, in the infrastructures in those countries. So here comes the problem of, you know, domestic instability. That, of course, if you are investing, you need to have, secure prospects or minimum secure conditions or stable conditions. So this is for the country where, resources are produced. You have also the problem linked to transit. And so here, of course, we can see that if you want to, of course, have, you know, an alternative pass to Russia. So you have the Southern Corridors. So this is crossing Caspian, Middle East. So obviously, places where you have a lot of instability. You have also, you know, the Eastern Med. You have, you know, all these pipes that are crossing the Med. So this is, bringing an additional layer on, complex package of security issues that tends to be very much intertwined. And so what we need to have in mind is that at the moment, where allies are looking very much to the east, we need to be, I would say, cognizant to the fact that at the end of the day, you know, challenges that are pre-existing to this crisis in the south are not going anywhere. So we will have a resource or a capabilities issue. If we are speaking only, you know, from a military point of view, I would say collective defense, we will still have to provide collective defense for the Met. And then in addition to that, we will have, you know, crisis management issues that we need still to take care of. And so this brings the question of who is providing capabilities. And so do we have the means to increase, I would say, our capabilities? And this is not only about money spending. You know, this is not about only increasing military spending. You need to have military spending that are matching, I would say, capabilities available on the shelves. And so from that perspective, I would say that European industrial cooperation, unfortunately, is not well placed, because only the US will be able to probably provide, you know, all the equipment and resources that we need to acquire. So this is part of, I would say, the global complexity that this war in Ukraine is bringing. We have geopolitics backs, you know, at the heart of Europe. And we have, I would say, a bit forgotten that. Geopolitics was something that was very much linked to the Gulf or, you know, to the Sahelian periphery. And so we have, you know, the geopolitical stakes, and today we have to deal with, I would say, a continuum of, you know, geopolitical challenges that start high north and run, you know, till the Sahel or a little bit south, down further south in, I would say, sub-Saharan Africa. So wherever you will have to shift, you know, priorities, you will need to find alternative solutions. So for the allies, this brings the question of how do you share the burden? And so this is an additional complexity to a very old, I would say, conversation about burden sharing between both sides of the Atlantic. And so here, and because the Madrid Summit is very close, we are expecting to have, I would say, a renewed impetus for NATO-EU cooperation. But of course, this is, you know, bringing, I would say, this prospect within a totally different framework. And so having European allies competing for very short-term solution to secure their supplies, this is also something that undermines cohesion. And so cohesion is our center of gravity. I mean, either in EU or in NATO. So this is where, you know, I see that we are, I mean, having a vicious cycle, and we need to find out, you know, the means to get out of this cycle. The problem is, this is very much depending of, I would say, national interest. And so to which extent European allies will be able to reconcile, you know, their national interest. This is linked to sanctions on Russia, what would be, you know, the consequences on our economies. And this is totally understandable at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go back to Carlos. And I will ask you, well, you already mentioned some of the hallmark projects or flagship projects you got in the Emirates, but I don't know if you want to highlight something, not only in the Emirates, but perhaps look into some kind of cooperation that we can do together, you know, between the EU and the Emirates. I mean, during this current crisis, is there some kind of support or cooperation that we can, I mean, as just Claude said, I mean, we have to look for new partners and new commitments. What do you think?
Sure, thank you, Othello. It's an extremely complicated question to answer. I will try to say something meaningful. And obviously, you know, the discussion is there for us. I mean, the region and the UAE in particular and the European Union, in reality, they share their goals. We both want to be net zero by 2050. And we both, you know, face not exactly the same, but there are a number of similar issues or challenges that we need to look at. In the case of the UAE in particular, I will mention a few things which would then take me you know, do a shared reflection about how to approach them and how to collaborate between these two regions. The UAE has a very ambitious nuclear program and a very ambitious photovoltaic program. The UAE wants to have a 60% reduction of emissions in the electricity sector in 2035 and be nearly zero by the end of 2050. The UAE has an electrification strategy. All the buildings are electric in the UAE, so we have to focus on transport and hard to decarbonize industrial processes. The UAE has to develop sustainable, clean and green hydrogen as, you know, a potential solution or part of the solution to the 2050 challenges. We need to look at things like the governance, the target model, because it's not so simple, you know, to realize how this is going to run among the different players in the region, the business models, the electricity supply, the availability of land, the certification scheme, the, you know, the use of infrastructures. All of these things are not written yet. We need to work on those. And so does Europe, by the way. We need to also look at things like energy efficiency, which is, you know, the elephant in the room. We cannot meet our goals without some things like energy efficiency and demand-side management. We cannot just, you know, have these one-way street for everything. We need to allow the consumer to participate in the process. And we need to do institutional reforms. We see things which are shocking, at least if you think for a second. We see that renewables are more and more competitive in terms of cost, but electricity continues to be expensive. So maybe let's think on what kind of institutional arrangements we need to have in the marketplace to figure out. And I'm not talking about capping anything. I'm just thinking about how to, you know,
this is
take about
an elephant in the room, by correct. The way.
how to look at these, all of these. So my point is here is technology, institutional reform, and you know, enablers for the energy transition have plenty of common ground between these two jurisdictions. I would really welcome, you know, a shared approach to increase the information flow, the missions and the visions that actually need to happen between these two regions, to choose two or three critical items and to see to what extent there is cooperation is happening. I see from there that parts of Asia are very present. China is playing an ever-growing role in the region. And I see that some countries in Europe, or the UK, if it's in Europe still, I'm not sure, have also a very close relation with the region. But the European Union, as such, maybe could be more present and share, you know, the knowledge and the institutional excellence that we enjoy in this part of the world. Because some of those answers are not only technological, it's how you get there. So,
for how long are we waiting for a free trade area between the GCC and the European Union? I mean, it's 30 years now? I mean,
at least. So, I mean, that is what I think. And finally, research, innovation, technology is going to be and will be the cornerstone of the whole success story. This is a clear area of collaboration. There should be competition in this area. So that would be my my last addition to the list.
Thank you, Carlos. I'm going to start to offset questions and answers rather than we go to capture questions and storage, because if not, we are not being able to do it. But hopefully some of the questions that I was thinking of posing to Mariana has been also posed by the audience, and it refers to hydrogen. What will be the prospects for hydrogen in the Middle East? You have already mentioned something, Noura, but Mariana, you have worked a lot on that. What can you tell us on that?
Yeah, thanks, Gonzalo. I don't want to start again saying, like, you know, as I've written before, but you have cited the papers of several of us during the past couple of minutes. So yes, decarbonization, including decarbonization of the European economy through hydrogen, and I'm saying that when it comes to our relations with the Middle East countries, yes, it may, to a certain extent, depoliticize interstate energy relations, and it is likely to limit geopolitical competition, like for access to fossil fuel reserves and supply, which is a shift from the post-World War II geopolitical literature, which was more centered towards you know, competition over petroleum resources and so on and so forth. Now, at the same time, yes, sure, the energy transition narrative puts into question the conventional energy security motive, but it seems that key threats, such as, I don't know, politically or economically motivated regional conflict, as we've seen these days, so these threats will still and for quite some time constitute an underlying underlying disruption incidents affecting both importers and exporters alike. So looking at the opportunities emerging from our conventional gas market, I would say first to have a look at the numbers, okay? So 2021, when it comes to the region, Algeria, oil-indexed imported pipeline gas came fourth with a share of 10.5% in the around 3,630 terawatt hours of gas imports in the EU as a whole. In this case, and that's also for future consideration, we have to take into account the dependence of the competitiveness of oil-indexed contracts on the evolution of gas hub prices and how this dependence, again, based on what we've been experiencing over the past couple of months, may create a competitive advantage for oil-indexed gas importers from the MENA, exporters, not importers, whenever and as long as you have this premium of spot contracts increasing over them. Second number that I would like to bring to your attention, Qatar becoming the second principal import source of LNG to the EU in 2021, with a share of 16.3 BCM out of a total 80 BCM of imports. In this case, we have to bear in mind two things, and I'm turning to your question about energy system integration, Gonzalo, and hydrogen. A, Qatar's current lack of spare LNG export capacity, although, and as Carlos might also well know, this is about to change with the lifting of the moratorium on the North Field expansion, and Qatar's long-term contractual commitments with Asian buyers. Second thing that we have to take in mind on the positive side, the low carbon intensity rate in Qatar's LNG supply chain and its commitment to, you know, increase this intensity by 35% by 2035 through CCS. And finally, and here allow me to quote CAPSEC research, we have the resource perspective, on the other hand, of prospective exporters from a sector coupling point of view, again to your question, Gonzalo, such as Saudi Arabia, which has both significant hydrocarbon reserves and high renewable energy potential, which is a fact significantly reducing both its natural gas and renewable electricity sourced hydrogen production costs. So this advantage may allow Saudi Arabia to become a major producer, A, and B, a low-cost global marginal supplier of low-carbon hydrogen if international trade in hydrogen develops. And one last thing, if I have a bit of time, because we're talking about, you know, this nexus with the European Union, it's also a matter of Europe's trajectory towards an established hydrogen market. Because when it comes to spot markets in particular, the hydrogen system does not exist in isolation. So the hydrogen system is going to be about close interrelations between natural gas and electricity markets, and that they will all have a requirement for physical balance or optimization. And this is exactly what energy system integration will be about. So there is going to be, you know, pricing interactions between this and all of this. And we know, for example, that you can develop salt caverns for hydrogen, and that there's going to be a line pack in hydrogen systems. So there will be seen as a single system to be optimized amongst traders as long as the markets are established properly. So you have the Middle East and North Africa region trying to find its place in a market under construction, let's say.
Thank you, Mariana. Thank you so much. We are going to the last round, and we are going to mix some questions from the audience with some questions I got myself. So I go back to Nora. There was that question, nitrogen in Saudi Arabia, but I think you have already answered. But if you want to complement or to elaborate further, that's your point. But I would like to ask you, going back to a more general trend, how do you see the role of the Middle East and the Gulf countries in the energy transition? What can the region contribute to the rest of the world?
Thank you, Gonzalo. So the Middle East is a very important region for energy and for other important aspects of the global security. You know, the Middle East comprises about 18% of oil and, 38% of oil and 18% of gas. It exports that to the world, and Saudi Arabia specifically is the global de facto leader in energy. And even with this energy transition, this role can be continued, especially looking at the potential of renewable energy in the region and in the country, as well as the important role, the potential important role in hydrogen. As we discussed, Saudi Arabia plans to be the world's largest green hydrogen producer, and there's been a lot of agreements and signing of agreements with other countries as potential importers of this hydrogen. So in general, the Middle East country has abundant solar energy potential as well as renewable energy potential, and there is a lot of potential in integrating the energy and the electricity grid, and so that provides a golden opportunity for exchange of energy and exporting of electricity, clean electricity, to Europe and the rest of the world. I'd like to also highlight the Middle East Green Initiative, which is a climate mitigation initiative by Saudi Arabia, as it's funding the afforestation of 40 billion trees across the region, and so the participation of the Middle East in the energy transition is important. But of course, the Middle East is not a homogeneous region. You have energy exporters, you have energy importers as well, and there are various various contexts to these countries. But I could say that the region, the Middle East region, should participate more in climate adaptation, given the needs of the countries. For instance, a lot of these countries are very water poor, particularly the GCC. The water poverty, as defined by the UN, is at 2,000 cubic meter per capita, and the critical water poverty is at 500. And unfortunately, all the GCC countries are below that. So they're critically water poor countries that highly depend on desalination, which highly depends on hydrocarbons for now. But there are many efforts for using renewable energy in the desalination. There's also very high temperatures that are really touching upon the physiological limits of humans. So you will need constant air conditioning and cooling, and so that also is dependent on hydrocarbons. So you have these needs for adaptation, climate adaptation, but you also have serious plans for climate mitigation through all these efforts in energy transition. So the Middle East's efforts in this energy, grand energy transition globally, is very important.
Thank you so much for raising the question of adaptation. We never talk enough about adaptation, especially in the region, you know. So thank you so much, Nora. I go back immediately to Chloe. My question, Chloe, and there is also a question related to this from the audience, is, okay, Bassam has told before, and you have been mentioned, risk and opportunities about the energy transition for the Gulf countries, but how can we approach this from a NATO perspective? I mean, do you see all these things, and Bassam was saying, beware of simplistic assumptions, you know, that this is going to be winners and losers, very clear-cut, but what's the perspective from a NATO? What's your perspective when you look at it from a security perspective? How this energy transition can further complicate the already complex situation in the Gulf and the region?
So I would say that if we are looking at, you know, this is the triangular, I would say, relation. So you have, of course, the consumer perspective, the producer perspective, and you have the transit perspective. And so you need to consider security, I would say, risks or vulnerabilities, you know, from the two perspectives and how they can, you know, conflict or how you can find a solution scenario that, you know, is trying to compromise, I would say, interests. So from the consumer perspective, I can say that from the moment we are actually transferring risks. And so we have a problem because we are already dependent. So we mean that it means that we lack, you know, diversifications in terms of resources, but we are at the moment actually just transferring that. So we are not diversifying our risk. And so this is a big problem. From, I would say, the consumer perspective. So if we are transferring, I would say, our interests, you know, on the Middle East, which is for, I mean, look at the figures that have been mentioned. It says already LNG from Qatar, they are already, you know, exporting a lot of gas and supplying gas, almost 100% to Belgium, UK. This is really big, big, big numbers. So the problem is that this dependency implies that you need to help those countries ensuring their own stability. And so also from the transit perspective, there are a lot of risks that are linked, of course, to, I would say, LNG shipping. So it's, I mean, getting back to maritime security. So this raised the questions of how are we stabilizing the Mediterranean basin, which is from a NATO perspective, I would say collective defense, but you need to also consider, I mean, the world route. And so we have here Red Sea, you go down to the Gulf of Aden, I mean, not mentioning what is happening in Yemen and how much, you know, this is obviously impacting the decisions of the players in the region. Look at, I mean, UAE was embarrassed because they were, you know, expecting, or at least they wanted to avoid to have, you know, Russia, I would say, you know, modifying a decision on Yemen. So this is just a very punctual example. So we can multiply those complex linkages to the security interests of those countries. So this is maritime security, classic for the Gulf. The problem is that now, if you are developing renewables, you will develop new infrastructure, and so you will develop new grids, and so you will have new interconnectivity, okay, to be ensured with other markets. And so this brings the question of how do you secure all this infrastructure? So cyber, but not only cyber, you have also, I would say, art, I would say, security issues that needs to be, I would say, taken into consideration. So this raised the questions of, I would say, security and armed forces capabilities, you know, in those countries. And so their ability to function, I would say, independently from a strong Western support. So there is here this interdependency that needs to be worked out. And so we have seen that in certain cases, when technologies is not delivered, those countries, and this is their sovereign prerogative, okay, they are looking for alternative options. And so Russia is one of those options, but we know that sanctions will probably impact also the defense industrial complex of Russia. So very soon they won't be able anymore to deliver, you know, one of these, I would say, you know, capabilities from the high end of spectrum. But this opened the questions of China. And so here we are already seeing that China is providing a lot of solution from a security perspective. So the problem is that Chinese investments in those, I would say, connectivity projects, I mean, I don't know if this is a risk or an opportunity. But I would say,
this is for next year.
I mean, some allies, to be very diplomatic, already considers, I mean, this was, I mean, great worries. And so this is a problem, having too much investments from one country, anyway, this is China or this is another country, and those infrastructure, I mean, raise concerns. This is true for the Gulf, 5G, not, you know, no necessity to mention other technologies. And so this is also true, I would say, in North Africa. So we have, you know, all these connectivity projects. Yep. If we want to develop renewables in North Africa, we need to be able to provide technologies at, I would say, an affordable price. And the problem is that you have affordable price, but you have also to have, I would say, political agreements that are allowing those countries to interconnect their markets. And so, for example, in North Africa, you see that political divides are actually very much impacting, you know, regional integration. And so this is true for North Africa. This is super obvious. But on the Gulf, we have also political divides. So this is also a question. Can you, I would say, provide for the future clean energy solution without having a GCC interconnected market? I don't have an answer. You have Iran that is still there and still something that the Gulf countries will have to deal with. So I would say from that perspective, I see that there are probably a lot of risk, but I'm sure that if you have a concerted solution, okay, and regional integration is, from my perspective, probably the best solution, you have also a lot of opportunities.
I see. I know I'm running out of time, but I will ask for 5 more minutes for 2 opponents, and then I give you the floor, Rafael, if you don't mind. May I? Because I would like to finish, because there are questions for you. Can you do it in 2 minutes, Carlos? One question about the mineral issue, the mineral transition you mentioned, and related to China. I mean, in the region, there are concerns about new dependencies from rare earths or minerals or whatever regarding China.
Well, in the region and everywhere, right? We are going to a new paradigm where electrification is a must. Electrification, not just with any means, electrification with renewables and clean technologies. And those technologies are intensive in a number of minerals which are located in limited amounts in specific countries. So we might be, and this is a huge issue that I think will impact the energy transition, you know, over a period of time. We are going to have to solve that if it's possible, or assume that there will be a dependency of the electrification and the energy transition from these materials. And I think that is not something specific to the Gulf or to the UAE, that is a global concern.
And I finish with Mariana, a very easy and very short question. What is the role of the Middle East region in the current energy crisis in Europe, in 2 sentences? No, I mean, you got 2 minutes.
Thanks.
Try to do, because I know that you got this holistic vision that you can put together energy, geopolitics. This is why I'm keeping that question for you.
No. Here, the question is very simple. Whether or not the MENA region evolves into a sort of energy powerhouse for its own people and for Europe at this stage. Addiction to hydrocarbons and, if you like, those untaxed prices at which you have petroleum products, at which you have natural gas, electricity, still mostly generated using gas or diesel, okay? Not compliant, diversion from a climate compliant perspective. And so does the absence of any direct control or on carbon emissions by way of a carbon tax or regional carbon pricing scheme, as I mentioned before. But at the same time, one cannot ignore that that despite the many practical issues that I have mentioned, that my distinguished fellow panelists have mentioned, you also have the incentives. And what are the incentives? In less than a minute, Dana, I will try. So dynamic price signals, you have green capacity auctions, you have green certificates, you have prospects for carbon pricing, such as, for example, Oman's tradable energy credit plan, or Saudi Arabia's plan on a voluntary trading platform for carbon offsets and credits in the whole MENA region. So the prospects, we can say, are there.
Thank you so much.
I was brief.
Very brief. But don't worry, because now Rafael Villaseca got the opportunity to make a summary and analysis of all you have said, all of you together. So, but before, please, I will ask you, the audience, to please join me in thanking not only the panelists, but also the interpreters that have been working for us all the morning. So thank you so much. Please.
Bueno. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias a todos. Thank you very much. Insights about all of the MENA region. Bueno, para finalizar esta...
And last, and to finish the session, we have Rafael Villaseca, president of the NAFTA-G Foundation. Good afternoon. It's truly a delight to be able to, you know, share some words at the end of this event. I'm not going to make a summary of all the things I have mentioned here, but I would like to share some thoughts briefly, given the time of the day, on the topic. And for the NAFTA-G Foundation, it is a relevant topic. As you know, one of our main ideas is to try to assess and analyze the world of energy, providing data and providing objective opinions that allow us and allow all the players to inform the decision-making process. And in the world of energy, I mean, it's an extraordinary complex world, and it requires us to know many details to make the right decisions. And that's why the foundation is devoting its efforts to promote events and seminars and meetings on many different topics, try to shed some light on the sector from an economic perspective, social perspective, from the regulatory perspective, or from the technical perspective. And of course, geopolitics, wasn't part of the things we were focusing, but it's not because it wasn't a relevant part of our sector. I mean, it's always been very important. If we take a look at the evolution of energy in Spain, we can very easily see the impact of geopolitical decisions. So the foundation is interested in providing data and information, and we believe that is something that the world of energy might be lacking to be able to face the challenges. And as you mentioned, now, you know, in the three objectives of any energy policy, and that's traditional, we are probably not meeting any of the three. We are not meeting sustainability goals. Energy is not cheap at all. Prices have increased, and last, security is at risk. And so, despite all the efforts carried out by many countries, Spain amongst them, the truth is that we haven't been able up to now to be able to advance clearly in the objectives we had set for ourselves. Clearly, the crisis in the Ukraine, it changes things and disrupts things, but it disrupts things because it makes things more severe and faster. But this is my personal opinion. That's my disclaimer. I mean, it's not changing anything. It's accelerating them and making it more severe. But I believe that probably the issues were there before. I believe that speakers might agree with this affirmation and this statement, right? And that should make us think, because data and science-based opinion are not solving the problem, but they really contribute to finding a solution. And we're not going to be able to solve it just having a partial view about the problem we're facing. And I mean, if energy issue is important, energy transition has increased the severity and the complexity of energy. Energy transition, which is something we need, is extremely complex. And we cannot see it from just one or two points of view. And when we don't do it, we have faced tons of issues. And so we have to be very much aware of the fact that we are facing something that has already been mentioned, which isn't fast, it's not cheap, and not easy to do. And sometimes we have to face reality, accelerated by the Ukraine, causes some sort of unease. But I believe that going forward in this topic, I mean, providing data might not be all of the solution. What is clear is that, trying to find solutions without taking data into account is, and that's why we should reflect in a more detailed way. And right now we are thinking about sustainability objectives, and we need to understand the geostrategic variable included. We must not be surprised. I mean, we're surprised by the crisis in the Ukraine, but not the geopolitical or geostrategic issues of the Middle East. That's normal. If Europe is leading, and it should, and it's desirable for Europe to lead climate change, it's true that only 10% of emissions and 90% are out of their scope. So if we take into account that the primary energy that it's using comes from out of the European Union, we will have to take into account geopolitics to avoid undesirable effects that are going to happen, because those countries that are not in the European Union are the energy suppliers that we need to keep on going forward today, and they account for 90% of greenhouse gas emissions. So taking that into account, it's not just circumstantial. Probably linked or next to and the regulatory framework and technology is one of the most important aspects. And that's why our foundation also wanted to deal with these topics. And we were very lucky to have the Real Instituto Elcano and Gonzalo amongst us. And we really want to thank you for your effort for organizing these sessions, starting with the Middle East, which is the birthplace of the energy issue. And we will try to keep on advancing and provide data and information from people who are as relevant as the members of the panel today, so we can try to shed some light on this issue. And just once again, you make decisions taking a look at the final goal. And I believe we have to be able to take a look at the path we have to follow to get to the final objective. The path is not secondary, it's essential. Some paths are going to be closed to quite swiftly. And we've seen it not only from a geopolitical perspective, but also from a social perspective. We surely have to take into account the transcendence and globality of the issue, also its cost, and of course, the path we're going to walk to get to our goals. Otherwise, we might be devoting a huge effort, and we might start walking paths that were undesirable and issues that might increase costs and probably disconnection with our societies. And I also want to be optimistic, because of course the reaction of society is important and it's powerful. So not just society, but also companies are constantly aligned. But I believe we should set the goal of trying to be rigorous and science-based. And I want to thank you for being here, both face-to-face and online. And we will try to offer you things close to what we have had here today, and with the collaboration of Instituto Elcano. Once again, I want to thank not just the Institute, but also all the participants. I'd like to close the session and thank you for your attention and interest. Thank you.